Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. My name is Mills. Thank you so much for watching. Today I'm going to do another true crime video, which I haven't done in a while, so I'm excited to do this one. And I've gotten a few requests for specific cases, so I'm going to do a case that was suggested to me a long time ago. If you like these types of videos, or if you like my channel, if you can take a second to hit subscribe, comment, like, anything, share with a friend, that would be amazing. I would definitely appreciate that. This case was huge in Puerto Rico. Pretty much like everyone knew about it. So I was not super familiar with this case. I had heard about it, but I didn't know it by name. But if you are Puerto Rican or if you're familiar with this case, I feel like you'll recognize it right away. And of course, I don't mean any disrespect to anyone that I'm talking about. I'm just compiling all the information that I have found about this case and presenting it to you. So of course there's little things that I'll miss on the way. Probably I'll throw in some things that you might not have heard before, but definitely no disrespect in any way to anyone that I'm talking about. Like I said, this case is very, very famous in Puerto Rico, but it did not get a ton of coverage in the United States, and I don't see pretty much any other videos about it kind of laying it out that I have found. Please feel free to link below if you have another channel that has covered this case, because I would love to watch it. Lorenzo González Cacho was an 8-year-old boy who lived in Puerto Rico in a city called Dorado del Mar. And it was a pretty affluent community or neighborhood that he lived in, and his family was pretty well off. He lived in a house with his mom and his two sisters, and his sisters were 13, he was 8, and then his little sister was 5. And Lorenzo was a super happy boy. He was adorable, as you can see in the photos. Super cute, loved to play soccer, and you can see a bunch of videos and pictures of him with his uniform and with his team playing soccer. So he just seems like an all-around kind of typical boy, 8-year-old, happy-go-lucky. On March 9th, 2010, he was unfortunately found injured in his home. So what happened that we first heard was he was home with his mom and his two sisters and nobody else in the house. Lorenzo's mother is Ana Cacho. She said that at 2 a.m. in the morning, so this would already be March 9th, 2010, she checked on the kids and they were all fine. And then around 4 a.m., the youngest daughter, the 5-year-old girl who was sharing a bed with Lorenzo, went and woke up her mom and said that Lorenzo was getting her wet with blood. So her mom, Anna, went to go check on Lorenzo and found him bleeding profusely. And she did not call 911, and she didn't take him to the clinic, like a hospital clinic that was only 5 minutes from the house. They didn't arrive until between 5 and 5:30. So she was in the house with him between an hour and a half after this happened, and then arrived at the clinic. Brought him in, he's still bleeding, profusely covered in blood. Anna told the nurses and doctors at the clinic that Lorenzo must have fallen off the bed, hit his head, and started bleeding profusely, or something like that, because she was in the other room. One of the nurses, this came out later, but he stated that he knew right away it wasn't an accident based on his injuries. So he had a fractured nose, but also a puncture wound near his nose on his face, and they couldn't determine what that had been with, like what the weapon was used to make that puncture wound. He had a fractured skull on the side of his temple, as well as like a cut above his eyebrow on the same side. And he also was found to have brain hemorrhaging. Unfortunately, he was pronounced dead at 6 a.m. on March 9th. Almost right away, Anna was arranging for his body to be cremated. I'm not sure if that's due to like religious beliefs or something, but it was pretty immediate that she just decided that that's what they were going to do. His father's name was Ahmed Ali Gonzalez, and he and the mother, Anna, were actually going through a divorce at this time, which is why Anna was home with the three kids and his father was not there. His dad right away when he heard what had happened, and then also that Anna was planning on having Lorenzo's body cremated so quickly, he put in kind of an executive, like a rush order for that to be stopped until they were able to do a proper investigation of what happened, and that went through, so the cremation did not happen right away. He receives an autopsy at this point, and he was pretty much when he was brought to the clinic, he was pretty much deceased at that point, but he was not pronounced officially deceased until 6 a.m. Once this order got approved for the cremation to not occur and the autopsy went forward, they found the three lacerations on his face, which they couldn't see at first because he was covered in blood. Again, they did not determine at first what those puncture wounds were from, but they did determine very quickly that those could not be sustained from rolling off of a bed. It was just a normal bed. It wasn't a super high bed. There was nothing like sharp on the ground. So it was pretty clear to them that this just like was not an accident. So directly after Lorenzo was declared deceased at 6 a.m. on March 9th, an officer was sent to Lorenzo's house to kind of keep guard and make sure that people weren't coming in and out of the house. This was Agent Jamie Cruz, and they were waiting for the arrival of the prosecutor on duty, who came at 9 a.m. So pretty much just there for 3 hours until the prosecutor on duty arrived. And her name was Mariela Santini. We kind of talked to Ana Cacho and the oldest daughter, which was 13, and asked them a couple questions, but in the reports they said that Ana Cacho was like super sad and like dejected and like barely answering the questions, which I mean, it makes sense why she would be super sad in that moment. She was just like kind of sitting to the side. And they took some pictures of the patio, the inside, the outside, the bed, and the bedding that Lorenzo was sleeping with when he was found. And that was pretty much all they did on March 9th. And then on March 10th, the ICF, which is kind of like the investigation unit, they come back with the prosecutor, Mariela, and another prosecutor called Wanda Cassiano, and a few different like agents and whatnot. They come back in, and Wanda's from the Child Abuse and Sex Crimes Unit, because this was a minor and he was a child, and obviously they determined that his death was a homicide. They needed someone in that area to come to the crime scene. So they took more photos, more videos of the area. They collected a toothbrush and toothpaste from like the outside courtyard area, and they had a bag with release documents from an inmate whose name is Luis Rivera Ciejo, and I'll get into a little bit who that is in a second, but it was basically just another check of the crime scene. On March 15th, they brought Ana Cacho into the police station, and they wanted to formally interview her, and she was accompanied by two of her lawyers who were very high-level lawyers. And again, her family was wealthy and well-connected politically in Puerto Rico, so that will tie in a little bit too. Then another kind of odd thing to me that stood out was the prosecutor, Wanda Cassiano, advised Ana Cacho kind of legally about giving her statement. Basically, Ana did not give any type of interview, and which I guess is within your right, you can kind of deny that, because she said that her lawyers advised her against it, as well as the newspapers and the public had already assumed that she was a suspect, so she didn't think that interviewing at all was going to help her. So I mentioned the name Luis Rivera Ciejo, I think I'm saying that right, I'm going to call him Luis. To back up a little bit, he was kind of quickly determined a suspect. I mentioned that the prosecutor had his release documents from prison with them at the crime scene on March 10th, just one day following Lorenzo's murder. He was a homeless man from around the area who was released from prison on March 8th, 2010, the night before the attack on Lorenzo. He was released by accident from the prison, which I'm not really sure how that happens, but he was in the prison for about a week or so, because the week prior he was brought in for the attempted murder of another man who then later died from his injuries. So basically the homicide of a separate man. So Luis, this man was not all there mentally. He had some mental disorders. He was missing one arm or part of one of his arms. So everyone called him El Manco. He said that when they released him from the facility, from the prison jail, He asked for a ride back to his hometown, but the taxi or the driver could only bring him to Dorado, which is right near where Lorenzo's family lived, Dorado del Mar. And he was arrested again on March 23rd, 2010, and brought back to jail because they had strong suspicions that he was a very likely suspect for murdering a man a week before and being in the exact area, like arrived there the very night that this happened to Lorenzo. Luis did admit to being around a Burger King that was right near Lorenzo's house around 2:30 in the morning, and the manager of that Burger King says that he did see him there. The end of March, they called in the FBI because they need backup. This was a huge case already. In just a month, it had completely blown up. Similar to the case that I covered, Emily Peguero in Dominican Republic, everyone knew about it. So there was a huge push and they called in that kind of like reinforcement. For this whole month, basically, remember this happened on March 9th, 2010, Ana still had custody of the two other girls, her two daughters, 13 and 5. It was a huge kind of public outcry to get those two other daughters taken away from Ana because she was also a suspect. And they were saying that those two other girls should not be in her custody, especially while they're figuring out what actually happened to Lorenzo and investigate the crime scene properly. On June 6, 2010, Ana Cacho was brought back for an interview, and she does give her version of events of what happened, that she just found Lorenzo like that, and she didn't allude to anyone else doing it or covering it up or really anything. It was pretty much just the facts on her side of, no, I don't know what happened. He must have fallen, and I was woken up by my daughter, found him bleeding. That's pretty much all the information they got that they already knew. On August 10th, they bring in Luis Riviera Ciejo and El Manco, and they interview him with the FBI. Now remember, he's not all there mentally, so I can only imagine kind of like how this interview went. But he said that he was in the area, and he did break into Ana Cacho's home, Lorenzo's home, and he was kind of like in the kitchen. He was looking for food. He took a knife from the kitchen, and then Lorenzo kind of blocked his exit, and that's when he attacked him. Ana Cacho said she didn't even notice anyone else in the home, and Luis said that he then jumped a back wall, and because it's a lot of the houses have like walls around them, and the release documents from the jail that he was just released from the night before must have fallen out of his bag when he was climbing over. Pretty much at this point, the FBI was saying, okay, we brought him back to the house, and he described everything again, and they presented the findings to the local justice, and they ended their personal investigation. But once they leave, it comes to light that Luis isn't really a solid suspect. There's lots of like conflicting evidence, and it seems like he was changing his story and he didn't even really know what he was confessing or why. So he kind of faded a little bit out of the light as a suspect at this point, while the local police and government were still trying to explore other theories and see, okay, who else might be suspects. During this whole time, Ana Cacho is a suspect, and it comes to light during this period that she was not alone in the house. It was herself and the three children, but she also had several men in the house with her, and at first she did not say that. One of these men was Arnaldo Colon, and he was in the house, rumored to be in the house during this attack. He was a suspect for a little bit, and there's not a bunch of like solid evidence that come out of this, but they did say that it's definitely suspicious that there were other men in the house, and Ana didn't say anything about that. On March 9th, 2015, so this is 5 years later, on the fifth anniversary of Lorenzo's death, he was declared kind of free of all suspicion, as were several other people. Another man that was rumored to be in the house was called William Marrero, and he was actually an ICE agent, immigration agent. Again, it was rumored that he was there, and he wasn't declared a suspect until 2012. But again, it's just suspicious that there's another man that was in the house that we didn't hear about for a while. Also on March 9, 2015, he was declared no longer a suspect at all. So that was the second man that was in the house. A third suspect at the time was Jesus Camacho, who was Ana's boyfriend at the time. He said that he was not in the house at the time of this murder. He was not in the house on March 9th, 2010 at all. And he was also later declared not a suspect, but they did look into him for a little bit. And then Ana Cacho, of course, the mom, was considered a suspect because her stories didn't always align. And they determined right away that his death was not an accident. And when she said she was the only one in the house at first, that's suspicious. On March 9, 2015, she was also declared no longer a suspect. So a couple inconsistencies that later came to light. March 10th, remember when they came back to do the more thorough search of the crime scene? People found out that the crime scene was not handled how it should have been. First of all, they didn't secure the crime scene right away. They sent a guard to the house, but there were family members coming in and out. Before leaving, the prosecutor, Santini, told Lorenzo's family that they could clean the bloody mattress with chlorine, with bleach, and start cleaning up the surrounding area as well, which doesn't make sense to me at all. So not only did they tell the family that they could clean it up because they didn't want the daughters to come home and see all of that and have to be exposed to it and it would be traumatic, they didn't collect it or bring it with them. They left the bloody blanket, didn't bring it into evidence at all. And there was a remote that was bloody as well, a fan remote control that was right next to this. They didn't collect that either. And Ana Cacho's father, so Lorenzo's maternal grandfather, he also publicly stated that the morning after, he went and he cleaned up the crime scene and he had the okay from the prosecutor. And they told him that that was fine to save the daughter's emotional trauma. He also pleaded with the FBI to get involved in the case. Remember, this is just before they came in. He did not have confidence in the local police to do a thorough and honest job. And Ana had also said things like that too, that she didn't trust that the police would do a good job and actually find who did this. So they wanted kind of backup from the FBI. It later came out that two investigators who were involved in this investigation, their identities were not disclosed. They said the whole thing started off on the wrong foot when Juana Cassiano passed off this kind of responsibility to Mariela Santini, another prosecutor, because she was celebrating her birthday, something like that. So she gave the instructions by the phone to Santini to tell her kind of like what to do in the protocol, which again does not sound completely by the book and thorough. And I'm sure, as all of you know, if an investigation starts off on the wrong foot from the crime scene, it can often be super hard to like get that back under control and on the right path and really find the true suspects of who committed this murder. Between 2013 and 2014, the FBI was involved again. They interviewed Luis Seijo again, and he went back and forth between saying he was involved, and then he renounced it and he said he was involved. He did take a knife from the kitchen. He did kill Lorenzo when he woke up and blocked his exit and he got scared and he just killed him. He went back and forth, and this was with the FBI with a whole new team of investigators. So they were clearly still looking at Luis and thinking that he did probably have a part in this. And then in 2015, there was a whole year of reinvestigation. They interviewed about 120 people, both in the United States and in Puerto Rico, from the FBI, from the local police, from the family, to try to gather all of the evidence that they could. And it kind of felt like they were starting over and trying to like do a better job than they did from the very beginning. And remember, this is 6 years later. And then on March 8th, 2016, a judge finds Luis Riviera Seijo guilty of murder of Lorenzo Cacho. On April 28, 2016, they dropped all these charges against Luis, and they dropped them again in June 2016 because they said although he confessed to this crime, they had no physical evidence, no fingerprints, no DNA, no further evidence that actually physically link him in the house or guilty of this murder. And like I said, the whole community was kind of in an uproar about all of this. Pretty much everyone just wanted justice for Lorenzo. They pretty much felt that, okay, we have various suspects from the mother to this random homeless man who was accidentally released from jail to the boyfriend at the time to two other random men that were rumored to be in the house at the time. They actually wanted, okay, but who did it and who will be held responsible? And then the public found out some other things throughout this whole timeline, and they're just like further outraged that not only is Lorenzo not getting justice, but they feel like there is pretty obvious suspects that are not being thoroughly looked at and like actually interrogated. A bunch of local news shows and like gossip kind of shows were just covering this case every single day. There were reports that Ana's father met with the governor at the time and handed him like a mysterious envelope, and people like saw that, but they didn't know what was in the envelope. The Secretary of Justice at the time actually renounced his position to be the personal lawyer for Ana Cacho, and he kind of went publicly and said that she was a victim of the media, even though a lot of people said like that looks really bad, kind of going from a public position to being her personal lawyer in a case that was so huge. And then finally, the only person to actually like give an interview was Jesus Camacho of the suspects from Ana, and then Colon and Marrero, the two other guys that were, one of them being an ICE agent, that were rumored to be in the house. Only Jesus gave a formal interview. So they're saying that is suspicious as well. And then with the whole thing surrounding El Manco or Luis Seijo, they basically said that the public just thought that they were using him as a scapegoat. Like I said, that he looked suspicious, but that there was no physical evidence linking it, and they took advantage of that convenience of, oh, he was right there, and his like mental disorders as well. And with the investigation, since they didn't do such a thorough job, everything was kind of like speculation. They did find drug paraphernalia, like I believe a crack pipe in the living room, and they tested it kind of right away. And then they tested, and they found Ana Cacho's DNA on it. But then they had her do a drug test and it was negative. So they're saying something might have been altered there, or someone might have been kind of paid off and she passed in that way. But that was another thing that was like thrown in there but never solidified if it kind of meant anything or what they found from that. Then some of the investigators said that there was also a knife that they found that had kind of evidence on it, blood on it, like days, weeks later, that was never collected. So basically there's just so many things with this case that weren't handled properly from the very beginning. Ana Cacho and her family ended up filing a multi-million dollar lawsuit against the University of Puerto Rico's medical campus, as well as kind of various like social workers and medical personnel there that helped them after Lorenzo's death. Ana Cacho, her mother, and then like various other family relatives, they claimed it was a violation of their civil rights. And Cacho basically said they suffered like immeasurable mental anguish and harm in those 9 months that they were separated from the two other daughters. Remember, they were taken from her 1 month after the death of Lorenzo, and they were placed with their father, who Ana was going through a divorce with. They said basically they were like suffering from extreme anxiety and depression, that they weren't able to be there for the two daughters to comfort them in the wake of Lorenzo's death. And they claimed that in the counseling sessions with social workers, they were basically turning them into sessions to get evidence from the girls and information about the crime rather than like addressing the emotional effects of this. I don't even know. Honestly, I think like, I don't want to speculate because I don't know what happened. I obviously wasn't there, but if Ana said that she was woken up at 4 a.m. and this happened, and then not taking Lorenzo to the clinic until 5:30, already right there, right from the beginning, it's like, that's suspicious. And I don't know if Lorenzo could have been saved, but I want to think that like he could have. And all of this back and forth between suspects and corruption, and well, Ana Cacho is well connected and she must be paying people off, or the investigators just aren't doing a good job and the crime scene was never actually investigated properly and they just like left evidence there. Between like that, the main point is that there has still to this day never been justice for Lorenzo. You guys know me, you know that I was crying researching this because, I mean, he was just such a cute child and 8 years old, and just still 2019, 9 years later, and still no one has been held accountable for this. It's just really disappointing. Right now, apparently, Ana Cacho lives in Massachusetts in the United States with her new partner and had twin babies, a boy and a girl, I believe. So she pretty much just like moved on with her life and had more kids. And I believe that the two other daughters, the 13 and 5-year-old at the time, I think that they stayed with the father in Puerto Rico, and he maintained custody from what I found. But yeah, basically there's a ton of people in Puerto Rico and around the world, and a bunch of Facebook like Justice for Lorenzo groups, and so many people who just want justice for him and for the person to be held responsible that did this. A lot of people think Lorenzo probably woke up and found things that he wasn't supposed to. Maybe he walked out into the living room and he saw his mom doing drugs with these men and or other stuff, and she was in the middle of a divorce, but it wasn't finalized yet. So maybe there's some speculation that he just simply saw things that he wasn't supposed to see, and they had to make sure that he didn't tell anyone. Of course, that has not been proven at all. It's just what people are speculating must have happened, because otherwise, what would be the reason for that to happen? It doesn't make sense. There was no other like evidence beforehand or like a pattern leading up to this. It was just kind of, you know, using the information that you have from the night, which is also kind of shady. But again, I don't know, and I'm not accusing anyone of anything. I would love to hear your thoughts below on what you think happened. If you know about this case, tell me if you've heard anything, if I left anything out. I couldn't obviously hit every detail since it's been 9 years, but I tried to get the most important ones. But yeah, if I missed something, or if you have any of your own like thoughts on what happened, please comment below. Share with anyone who you think might like this. Thank you so much for watching. Hit subscribe if you would like, and leave any other suggestions for a true crime video below. And then I already have a few other ones picked out for kind of like located in the United States, specifically Arizona. But just let me know if there's any others that you would like me to cover. I'd be happy to look into them. Thank you so much, and I will see you guys soon.